This month, we're asking for your support through our premium programs via the Escapist Plus and YouTube memberships. Your support allows us to continue making the content we want instead of chasing algorithms or the latest trends. Plus, you get a bunch of perks like ad-free viewing via the Escapist Plus on our main website, early access on YouTube via YouTube memberships. You can even ask us questions for our Ask the Creators video series. Thanks for all your support, whether it's with these programs or your general viewership. Hey there, Internet! My name is Jack Packard. Hell hath no fury like a can of creamed corn here for The Escapist. This week, doing something a little bit different. I'm not talking with Nick, our editor-in-chief. I get to do a grown-up business thing. I'm doing a professional thing. I am interviewing a games developer. So with me today is Mr. Edmund McMillen!
Hello! Hello, everybody. I'm the most professional game developer there is to interview, so...
I'm so happy that I have you to talk with and not, like, someone who will make fun of me.
Well...
So a little bit of backstory. Edmund, for those who don't know, according to Wikipedia, you have been making games, developing games for the past 20 years, making titles such as Dead Baby Dress Up, Gish, Aether, Meat Boy, Spewer, Time Fakak, Super Meat Boy, The Binding of Isaac, The End is Nigh, and The Legend of Bumbo. And that is a handful selection of all the games that you have been a part of. So first, I guess, congratulations. 20 years making interactive fiction.
Yeah, that's half of my life. It's weird. It's weird to think that. Like,
yeah.
I mean, you'd think I'd learn more by this time. I'm starting to question my growth ability, my ability to grow. I'm still doing poop jokes, and dead baby jokes are all still there too. So not moving past that. I'm keeping it real.
But do you have to, is the question.
Obviously not. I've got my finger on the pulse of what's cool these days. Poop and child abuse.
You're not doing Flash anymore, because obviously Adobe just killed Flash. Did you have a private little memorial for Adobe killing Flash?
You know, I'm going to still be using Flash as an art tool, as an animation tool, you know, because that's what I know and I like. I like my lines in Flash. It's easy to animate in Flash.
Nice, clean lines.
When it comes to the death of Flash, you know, it was a fun time while it lasted. It was very fun.
I'm just thinking, like, I know you got your start like making Newgrounds games, yeah. You're like making free web games, and that's how you grew your name as a game maker. And Flash was the tool to do that.
For sure. I mean, it was just starting out when I started. And I think it was because I was making comics like through high school and I couldn't get published. My stuff was too not something that they said not something I can get behind as a company, which I didn't understand. So I was just making zines and self-publishing comics and stuff like that. And I just wanted to put my comics online. I needed to learn how to do that. I dropped out of college after like a week of going to, I went to the University of San Francisco for 5 days.
Oh, okay.
And I didn't have enough money to continue. They needed like upfront money, even though I had scholarships and I came from a very poor family. And so it wasn't an option to have $30,000 to give them. And I did not have that money and I wasn't going to put my grandma more into debt in order to keep going. But, the cool thing was, is I was able to take those scholarships and apply them to community college classes. And I got a bunch of like, take whatever. And I lied. And I told them, since I technically was enrolled in the university, like the San Francisco Arts Academy, I was like, I took all these prereqs. I took them all.
Yeah.
So I just went into the like more advanced stuff and I just jumped in and I think I passed like two or three of my classes, but I mostly went to learn the tools, essentially. So I took a bunch of I took Dreamweaver and Flash, 3D Studio Max, a bunch of Photoshop, stuff like that. And I was living with my grandma at the time, and I just took it home, made my websites, and started making them interactive with Flash, and slowly moved into interactivity. Didn't even realize I was kind of making games at the time, but I guess I was kind of making games at the time. I just wanted to make interactive comics. And it started out with just a little arrow you click to go to the next page. And then it's like, well, I can also drag and drop this arrow.
Ooh, the amazing technology.
So I could make a paper doll, right? I can make a paper doll. So I can dress it up and stuff. And that became Dead Baby Dress Up, which was the first interactive game that I made.
Right. You know, that's actually one of the things I wanted to talk to you about, from Dead Baby Dress Up, from your, I think you've self-described them as edgelord comics, because we've all been edgelords, let's be honest with ourselves.
It's true.
From Dead Baby Dress Up to, Dead Baby Heroes with The Binding of Isaac, do you feel like as you've gotten older now, as you've been, half of your life has been dealing with these edgelord things, do you feel yourself calming or de-edgelording, dull lording?
it's a weird, admittedly, growing up in the 80s, it was hard not to be anti-establishment, anti-religion, sort of, and it was very easy to say and do salacious things that were funny. And also still ruffled the feathers of the man, right?
Yes. Yeah.
That's totally changed now. The man, I don't even know who the man is anymore.
There's too many men.
But there's something in, I think there's an attractiveness to saying something that makes somebody react in a certain visceral way. It was an easy way for an artist to get an emotional reaction from somebody.
Yeah. Yeah.
Even if it's not anger, it's laughter. And that's kind of what I think I was doing back then. But I wasn't ever trying to just be controversial to be controversial. I guess, I was angry at where I was in the world and wanted to lash out in some way. And the only power I had was in this imaginary world where I could make my own comics and then force people to look at them in stores.
But then that started the cycle, right?
Yeah, exactly. And that's kind of what it is. And I'm still doing it now. People ask me, why did you do these weird themes for The Binding of Isaac that so many people play? It's a part of me, I wouldn't say gets off, but a part of me, I won't tell you what part, a part of me gets off. Now. A part of me gets off on knowing that I'm making something that is fun, that's forcing somebody into my world and experiencing it. I don't know, just bringing somebody who wouldn't normally get pulled into a racer head or something, something, your mom or whatever, pulling somebody in with, something that is appealing that forces them to experience something that they wouldn't ever totally, and they would never be interested in or experience in any way or think about or anything like that. So there's definitely something there. Maybe that's just how my weird broken social thing. I want to connect with somebody like that. I was the kid who would always had to put his own music on the jukebox at the bowling alley. Right. Cause I wanted other people to hear it because I thought it was so good and so interesting. And I,
this is important to me. Yes. It really should be important to you. Too.
There's something here. And I know that and that's just my personality type. So there's definitely a lot of that in there where I really enjoy the idea that so many people are into a game where you're an abused naked child crying.
Well, and like you said, it's wrapped up oh, here, you want to play just this, silly twin stick shooter.
Yeah.
But, then they get little pieces of these of this piece of you that you're trying to share with them. And, I know you and I have talked before, journalistic integrity aside, you and I have talked before.
I may have met you at some point on the internet.
We we may have had a conversation or two. You know, I know you and I grew up in very similar, very religious households. And so kind of helping to share, exercise some of that through your art is, I know, one of the reasons why I personally latched on so much to Isaac. And so, like, a fun way to share a little bit of you. I think that's great.
For sure.
And so do you see yourself... Do you see yourself leveling off the edge then, or do you just see the world has less edges?
I don't know. I mean, I don't think the world has less edges. I believe that a lot of people want to act like the edges aren't there. Ignore the edges.
Yeah.
I think the edges will always be there. For me, it's not so much about edges and more of just at this point in time, I will continue to write about my own personal experiences abstractly through my work. And I'm interested in things that are weird. And I still believe weird things are mostly counterculture for the most part and may appear edgelordy to some people because they're, you know, I mean, the question I get all the time is why poop? Somebody asked me why poop, why buttholes? And I said, well, because poop comes out of buttholes, but outside of that, the obvious, you know, there's something to the idea that having poop in a game is somehow weird when we all poop and look at our poop and wipe our poop. Like it's a daily, hopefully a daily experience for so many people in the world. It's a universal thing. Yet it's considered so weird to even discuss. And It's that little bit of interesting, there's a little interesting social weirdness there for me and enough for me to be like, I'm going to put poop. That's funny.
I've always considered poop to be the great equalizer. Cause like they remember like the old saying is like, if you're ever nervous speaking in front of a crowd, picture them naked. And to me, like that never made any sense because other people look really good naked and I do not. So it's like that doesn't help, but everybody poops and it's all gross.
For sure. And I even did a poll online once about how do you wipe your butt? Because I realized, well, obviously girls wipe their butt differently than boys for the most part, somewhat.
You would assume, yeah.
But that's where it started. And I was like, well, let's do a poll. How do you wipe your butt? And oh my God, there's a range. You would have no idea. There is such a huge range and it is all over the place. Like some people do the in between the legs wipe. Some people go back. Some people stand. Some people go sideways off and wipe sideways. And some people only stand and they wipe those different ways, standing only. It's just like you would never know it because absolutely nobody talks and has these discussions.
These are the important discussions. Like the only
and that's what I'm here. That's what I'm here to shine light on this. The importance.
Exactly. The only reason I ever wanted to exercise was so I could get my squat game so good to, you know, really clean that place out.
I have friends that it was revealed that they shower after they poop.
Every time?
Every time. They don't poop that often. And when they do, they shower. They have to be very clean. I know. Everybody's different. I was like, one friend. No, two.
What?
I know of two people. It's probably not as rare as we think.
Sure, but it's like, what's your fiber intake like? Bidets exist. You don't need to.
Wet wipes exist too, but
yeah, they say those are bad for the environment. Now we've moved on to bidets.
Okay,
heads up.
I
even though they say flushable on them, they are actually not flushable. That's a thing for anyone who's interested in wet wipes.
Well, I'll have a talking to with my daughter then. She's terrible for the environment.
Kids in general are terrible for the environment.
Yeah.
That's just true. But okay, I'm gonna move us on from poop now.
Okay.
Sorry for all of the fecal enthusiasts.
I told you this was the most professional interview ever.
That's what we're here for. Getting back into the game side of things, I want to talk about your perspective. You have a very deep insider perspective. The Binding of Isaac was one of the first in the wave. Like basically you helped create a popular new genre. You were part of that wave. You know, if you look at Binding of Isaac, Spelunky, Minecraft, procedural generation, the new wave of roguelikes.
Yeah.
I've heard stories that you went procedural generation just as a way to get more content cheaper and faster, basically. But like, how do you feel about this genre now that basically you helped start it?
Well, I mean, I helped a little bit, but
I'm sorry, your game that was procedurally generated in roguelike was very, very popular.
Yeah, okay, sure. I guess people are still playing it 10 years later. Sure. but there's so many of them. When I started getting interested in the original roguelike genre, was probably around Super Meat Boy time. And then Derek had released the original version of Spelunky, which I initially didn't grab me because the controls were a little funky in the original.
Yeah.
And they took a little getting used to, but the idea was still there. And there was another game called Desktop Dungeon, which was another kind of abstraction of the roguelike genre. And it just seemed like the thing that I liked about it the most was it felt like new arcade. It felt like new high score. It was infinitely replayable. And I was like, well, I want to make one of these kind of games. And the roguelike that I was going to make was Mugenics. And I was going to make it with Tommy way back then. And I was like, it was like right when Meat Boy released, there was a bit of downtime for us. And Tommy had taken a vacation for his then girlfriend. And while he was on vacation, I was like, well, I want to do something that's relaxing to me. And I thought, well, it would be fun to do a super low stress, no expectations flash game. Mm. And I could also prototype random generation, because then I'm going to use that in Mugenics. So I want to prototype this, you know, this little game. And I contacted Florian, who I made a bunch of flash games with. I want to say he's a kid from Austria, but he's not a kid anymore, but he was a kid when I met him. He was very young.
Now,
when I met
like
him.
The rest of us, he's an old man from Austria.
Yeah. He's old now. And I'm like, hey, you want to do this? And he was always the person that I worked with. So I worked with so many different programmers over the years. And
yeah,
there are certain ones that aren't up for everything. And Florian was we made the C word together. So he was up for anything. So I was like, I want to make this game. It's going to be, you know, originally it was this critical take on religion, and it was going to be about child abuse, and it was going to be just super disturbing. And based off of a lot of, I was watching a lot of 80s Christian propaganda, Satanist stuff.
Oh, sure. Sure.
D&D, I mean, the D&D scary days, you know,
the satanic panic of the 80s. Absolutely.
And, I pulled so much from that, of like weird stories that were obviously lies, of like people being taken into cults and being thrown into a well of fetuses, and, you know, and like, or piles of babies, you know, stuff like that.
Would you roll the dice on heaven?
And I got really into Jack Chick at that point in time. Do you know Chick Tracks?
Chick Tracks, of course. The very, for anyone who doesn't know, very tiny like comics that was all religious propaganda.
It was, it was out of control. Oh my God. It was like the craziest stuff you could imagine. Super, super harsh, but entertaining in that very dark way. I collected the hell out of those. I got really into those. I even tried to get some of his art.
Oh, really?
Before he died. He died. Yeah. And they said they would send me something, and I was so excited, and I opened it up and it was a photocopy of just one of his drawings.
Oh, come on.
It wasn't even signed or anything. But I mean, that's a whole other story. Anyway.
Sure.
But yeah, so I was just pilfering Christian satanic panic propaganda. I was super into it. A lot of the old videos I remember pirating, downloading off of, I can't remember the website, but there was a bunch of Christian propaganda stuff off of there. It was like Pokemon was evil and Harry Potter was evil and all this other stuff.
It's witchcraft and wizardry. Yeah, that's evil.
It is. It brought me back to my childhood, where half of my family would like take away my magic cards or my D&D books or whatever else and sit me down and talk to me about how my uncle sat me down and said, "Do you know you can't kill me?" And I said, "What?" I said, what? No, I said,
watch me try, old man.
And I was like, huh? Because God wouldn't allow it. You couldn't cast a spell on me that would harm me. It's just because I had a starter deck of Magic the Gathering in my backpack when I visited.
Yeah.
It was the creepiest thing. It was just like being cornered. Like, he isolated me in a room, just me and him. And I don't even really know this guy. And he's just telling me all about Jesus, but in a very threatening way. Like, he was like, just so you know, I've got backup. Don't try anything. Like, and the backup I got is legit. So it just brought me back to that. And then I was thinking, like, okay, well, I wanted to make a roguelike. I wanted to reference something that existed already that I could randomize. And that was the Legend of Zelda dungeon structure. Mm-hmm. So I took basically the structure of most of the dungeons and retooled them, reworked them into a randomly generated environment. Mm-hmm. And then I was like, well, if I'm doing Legend of Zelda, then I might as well like look into what it was about for Miyamoto when he made it. And it was about him exploring as a kid. So it was like, I could totally feel that, because I did a lot of exploring as a kid as well. But I thought, well, what could I do to make it more like me? And then that's when I was like, okay, well, I'm going to dive into my childhood and what's going to come out. And that's what came out, because I was really into the Christian propaganda at the time. And yeah, I dove deep into that and my feelings on, you know, being an outcast in a very devout Christian and Catholic family. And if I don't fit in and I don't believe in this stuff, am I an evil kid? Am I wicked? Am I born wrong? You know, mm-hmm. all that sort of stuff. So I wanted to explore that. And basically, like, initially, I think it was going to be more of a pretty harsh criticism of Christianity and how it could negatively affect, especially a creative kid or just an outcast. Make them feel even more like an outcast and lash out and, you know, become the evil thing. I remember when I was young and they were like that, I remember thinking like, well, I'll play the part. Like, I'll be extra spooky and I'll be extra weird. And, you know, that sort of thing pushed me a little bit. And I can see that it was just a fun dive into my childhood once again. 3 months later, the game came out and it was just a flash game and I didn't know what to do with it. And I remember showing it to a bunch of other developers and they're like, this is pretty good. You should put it on Steam. And I didn't think that this was back before anybody could put anything up on Steam, you know, like you had to have a contact there.
This was when Steam was still curated. Yeah.
So I had a direct contact to Steam and I asked him if I could just put it up for cheap. I remember crossing my fingers, like, oh, I felt like I was totally pulling the wool over. Like, I was taking advantage of Steam here. Like,
yeah.
Like, this is a piece of shit game, you know, using a piece of shit engine. And I'm totally taking advantage of it. And I may be like really pushing it. And I don't want to like cause any issue with them. And I would like, my emails were like, listen, okay, if anybody says anything, we can wrap it in an EXE. It won't be the SWF. It'll still look like Flash, but we can optimize it and all this other stuff. And they're like, yeah. Sure. I mean, Super Meat Boy did well. You probably got a fan base. Go ahead. You can put it up. And initially it didn't really wow that many people, but over time, I think people slowly kind of got it. People seemed like it took a little while, I think, originally for it to click that you're supposed to replay it.
Sure.
Like, even to people now, like I'm friends with George Fan, who made Plants vs. Zombies. And I was like, you played Isaac. And he's like, oh yeah, I played it a while back. You know, I beat it. And I was like, you beat it? And he's like, yeah, I killed mom. And it's like, if George fucking Fan beat mom and then thinks that that's the end of the game, I could only imagine there's quite a lot of other people out there who probably feel the same way and don't realize that that's like kind of the beginning of the game.
Yeah, that's such an interesting perspective. Absolutely.
But yeah, it definitely wasn't what people were playing at that point in time. And a lot of the reviews were kind of like, this is just a rehash of Legend of Zelda, but it's a shooter and it's fun, you know, that's it. But it took people playing it a lot, like streaming it a lot, to kind of show how it's played. kind of like a Minecrafty sort of thing. It kind of like had a viral aspect to it. And then like six months after release, it started selling like twice as much as the first release week, and then three times and four times. And like, it kept going up. And they kind of exploded.
No, I know. That's how I found it. It was a streamer I was watching was going through a couple runs, and oh, I died here. Oh, ooh, this seed. And I'm sure it crashed more than a couple times. And the streamer was just like, no. Trust me, this is the game to play. oh, I got this item. This item's broken, but trust me, this is the game to play.
Yeah. I mean, that's how I like felt making it too. It's like, it's still fun. It's still good. I don't know. Yeah, even though the development was short, at so many points during the later stages of development, it was like, this isn't good enough. This is not, it needs more. It needs more to feel alive. It needs more to feel like it's always different. And we just kept adding and adding more. And then 10 years later, we're still doing that.
That's an interesting thing. Like there's two follow-ups I want to ask you about your answers there, which is one, which is I love that story about someone saying they beat mom, they beat the game, kind of short. how do you as a developer take that feedback? Like, how do you then like turn around and try to incorporate that into your game? Or do you just say, F it, if you don't get it, you don't get it?
Wow. I tried to make progression make sense. So when you beat mom for the first time, stuff pops up and says, this appeared in the basement, this is unlocked, this is this. So it pushes the next run. Like I remember,
sure.
I mean, I had absolutely no idea that people were going to play it as much as they actually did. I thought it was just going to be, you know, once you do your completion mark, you're done and that's the end of the game. But like, and there was only a few back then. I was trying to, you know, put the carrot there every time, like they did something significant, either the game would open up a little more. And I was trying to push that. But I guess I don't think I overthink that aspect at this point. I know there's people out there who assume that they've beaten it and they haven't, but I put up a little thing that says you haven't beat the game. you should keep replaying it. But I mean, I try to
stretch picture of you holding up a sign.
Yeah. Or... keep playing. I tell you when you're supposed to stop playing, then that doesn't work either. So,
right. That's true. You gave us 110% completion. That's right.
Yeah.
The other aspect that I think is really telling, and I remember hearing stories about this that, you know, when you were working on Super Meat Boy, is, you know, you really believed in Super Meat Boy, but the suits didn't necessarily think that the game was going to sell well.
One suit liked it.
Oh, okay.
He's great. That's our guy. His name's Kevin. That was our guy. He's the one who campaigned for me to even come and make a game on Xbox. Like he liked my stuff and he wanted me to make whatever I wanted to make, but he's the only person out of everyone that liked anything I was doing.
Right. Well, you know, you pushed through because you believed in the game and obviously Super Meat Boy was a big success. And you know, here with The Binding of Isaac, we have a situation where you don't necessarily believe that it's going to be a big success, but you're still enjoying it enough to push through. And so like just the concept of as an artist, trusting your own instincts, is that something I hear this a lot from like newer artists or younger artists where, you know, they don't necessarily believe in themselves. Is that honed just over the years of making crap or is it something that you've worked on?
I don't know. Like the rebound off of Super Meat Boy. So even though, you know, I got to do what I wanted with Super Meat Boy, it felt like I was playing nice. there was still some amount of compromise there because I'm working with a bunch of suits and I'm investing years of savings and time. And I'm also investing, you know, Tommy's savings and time and, you know, I can't gamble. I wasn't comfortable gambling on something as risky as one of my previous projects. Like jumping into Meat Boy, like Meat Boy could have been any other remake of any other Flash game that I had made. Originally it was Gish 2 was what, oh, and sure. then it became a remake of Gish. And then when that didn't happen, I was like, okay, well, I have my most popular Flash game is called Meat Boy, and it's a platformer. It's easy to do, you know, shouldn't be an issue. And I made a lot of platformers since, so I thought I'd be able to do it. But it still felt like a compromise. So after that, I wanted to make something where I didn't compromise at all. And I wasn't thinking about money at all. And I'd like to think The Binding of Isaac is probably one of my purest, you know, free form moments. It's Binding of Isaac represents me the most out of anything I've ever done. I was able to just go hard. And there were times where I'm like, do I want to do this? Is it genuine? Yes, it's genuine. Just do it. Like, just put it in. And it doesn't matter because you're financially secure and you can do what you want because you're an artist. And I just wanted to get back to that too. And there's a part of me that was scared, like that I was just going to compromise from now on. And I was just going to try to make money and make more money. And, sure. and I was going to try to play ball, you know, with these people and not be independent, you know, emotionally and creatively. And I really wanted to do something super off the wall and super strange. And I'd say that The End Is Nigh was also another one too, that was like that, where it's tied for me as far as the most personal projects that I put out there, where I didn't think about what people would think, say, if people would buy it or not. I'm a harsh critic of my work. I know when something's not up to snuff, and yeah. That's all that matters to me. You know, I've yet to read a review that is as harsh as how I think in my head when I'm looking at my work. So and it's relieving in a way too. But yeah, I'd like to think that some aspect of that is why The Binding of Isaac was successful. But you know, I'm probably kidding myself in some way. It's just the artist desperately wanting to feel justified for being able to be free and do whatever they want to do.
Like I personally think that's just after years and years of making stuff. And you know, I'm sure you've had many failures. You've had projects that you loved and didn't really land with audiences. You've had projects that maybe you didn't think too much about and blew up. And so just like, to me, it's just the end result of repetition. You've honed your skills enough where you say, oh, I like this. I trust my own artistic feelings. And I think for younger artists, that's the takeaway, is just keep making stuff and pay attention to what lands with people. Right?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, you have to, it's such a complicated medium. Like, it's a stupidly complicated medium. I mean, it's like making movies, but also you're thinking about gameplay. Like, it's just a weird, you're trying, it's a new language. And in a lot of ways, I think a lot of games lean back on using other mediums to convey story and theme and whatever else, without really pushing into gameplay. But that's kind of a whole other thing. But I'd like to think, as an artist, as long as you approach things as genuinely as possible and you are honest and realistic and you know who you are and you know what's good and you have things to compare those things to, you'll grow pretty fast and you'll be free to just experience and throw things out there. And you can't be afraid of failure. I know so many people who are so afraid of failure. You learn so much from failing. I even learn so much from failing. Isn't as bad as not releasing something. Not releasing something is the worst. Like, I've worked on projects for years and then they don't release. And it is a sickening feeling. It was worse than failure. I would much rather put out a game. Like, we'll use Bumbo as an example. So Bumbo is, it's almost there for me, but it's not. I think that with some of the fixes that we're working on currently, it will be something that I'm proud of. But currently, it's not something that I'm proud of. I knew going in that it was almost there, but I felt like if we didn't release it that year, it wouldn't ever get released. And it was just a lockdown situation. Like, this was the longest dev cycle of any game I've ever worked on. We needed to release it this year. it shouldn't be as complicated as it is. It needs to come out. and it suffered from its first week of launch. That's for sure. It's almost there. It's almost there. And I think with the edits that I'm working on now with a new team that, it'll be there. I mean, I think it'll still be a good game, but it's definitely not, it's definitely obviously below the Binding of Isaac and below The End Is Nigh and below Meat Boy. But I think it's still, it's one. Imagine if it came out
hold on
2 years before and you're like, whoa, I've never experienced this kind of deck building game before, because five years ago when I came up with a fucking idea, I was like, this is amazing. And it was kind of actually loosely based off of Magic the Gathering and Plants versus Zombies, which was kind of this like deck building, abstract deck building game as well. And then, you know, a year or two into development, Slay the Spire came out and I was like, oh, and then like Dicey Dungeons came out and I was like, oh.
Yep. And now there's a glut of deck building roguelikes. Yes.
I've always wanted to deconstruct something that felt like a game your mom would play and kind of deconstruct those mechanics into something that I think is neat. But it's once again, when I read comments and people are like, this is just Bejeweled with deck building. And it's like, yeah, but that's not the best, but that's good. that aspect of it is awesome.
Oh, I'm sorry. I made a game like the most popular game on the planet. Sorry.
Yeah. So, I mean, it was a little challenge going in. It was my first 3D game. You know, it was a rough dev cycle. I can tell you that much.
Sure.
I mean, it also hit like right around the time, like I think when I had started, it was around the time that I left Team Meat. And shortly after doing that is when I started The End Is Nigh. And so I was at a really dark, low spot. And I'm just very proud of myself and James for just fucking releasing that goddamn thing. And it's better than I'm making it seem, but for me, it's still one of those things that just kind of gets me that I wish it was better, because I felt like the potential was quite there, especially even in its visual design. I think I felt like there's a lot of potential there that,
I agree.
Wasn't explored as deeply as I usually would to simply put the game out.
I think that's fair. I mean, I put a bunch of hours into it and still enjoyed it overall, but I can see where you're coming from of just, you know, smoothing out those rough edges.
For sure.
I want to get to you as a game developer developing also for physical games, as you've had two successful Kickstarters now, both for Four Souls and for Tapeworm. And kind of the difference there where you get to make a tactile thing and playtesting is different and balance updates are different. And what's you reached out to something very, very different in developing a board game.
Yeah. It's so fun to make. I love programmers. I've worked with them for a long time. And anybody who's listening, I love you. I love you, you programmers that I've worked with. But oh my God, it's so much easier to make a game without a programmer.
we might have to cut that.
No, it's freeing in a way to be able to just work on design and visuals. As somebody who's just does design and visuals. And I had a blast working on Four Souls. That was the one that like, it looked for me, my life looked like this. It was like The End Is Nigh was like this super like developing as I was so depressed. It was just like all the way down. And I was like, I don't want to make games anymore. And then it came out and I was like, oh, I'm very proud of it. And I feel like I could make games again. And then Four Souls was like, phew! And it was like, oh, I don't even have to fucking make video games anymore. I could just make, you know, I can make physical games and I can make games with my wife and I can play test things with my family. Like it's like my friends come over and we get to play these games. It was fucking cool. I loved every, it revitalized me in almost every way that you could imagine. It made me feel good again. It made me not stop hating, you know, the industry. I felt like I broke away from this industry that I don't really like. And this environment that kind of feels weird and yucky. And I got to just dive deep and develop something with my wife. The campaign was really fun. I liked the social interaction. I liked thinking out of the box. I liked the, so that Kickstarter was improvised day to day. I fucking made it up as I went. And that was awesome. I felt like, I felt like I was on this really fun roller coaster ride of creativity where I got to make shit up. I get up in the morning, make a phone call, call Javon, be like, hey, can you make this? Can we make this? Can we do this? Can you do this? Yes, we'll do it. It's like I had a small team of people that I could like be like, can this, is this possible?
Yeah.
And of course I'm really bad with money. So like we lost money in different places and dumb things I wanted to do, but it was still super fun. And it was like, you know, you wake up that morning, like, all right, let's do an ARG. Let's start, you know, hiding pieces of a card around town and, you know, do all these weird, I don't know. It was super cool. I'm super proud of it. Mm-hmm. I think the game is super fun. And it's just starting to kind of take off now, a few years later. Now that we've sold out, and we're going to be doing another Kickstarter to kind of resell it again, repackage it, fix up a few minor, balancing issues and wording issues and kind of redo the instructions a bit. So it's more clear. That's the one shortcoming that I had was I'm not great at using words to tell you how to play. I use gameplay. And I've been doing that for a very long time. So it suffered. But now we have like, man, oh my God, the community is insane. Like I've got multiple people like pinging me with like crazy PDFs full of rewrites that explain everything really eloquently. And yeah, it's the written word is not something I'm.
That's okay. That's okay. Well, and do you think that, like you described your feeling developing it, your excitement developing it. Do you think that was just because you were actually playing instead of writing or coding?
Yeah.
There was just that, feeling of
instant gratification. It was like, hey, let's play this game. We sit down and play it. So what I usually do, and this is what I recommend for any developers out there who are also testing, you don't play. You watch other people play, and that's how you understand how they understand your rules. They understand how the game plays, and you get a better idea because you can look at their faces and you can see when there's, you know, boredom. You can see when there's, you know, happiness, joy, anger, and whatever else. And I tuned to their expressions. You know, you write down your little notes and be like, oh, this interaction made this person angry and caused a rivalry. They said they didn't like it, but you can tell that was a high emotional moment that still lasted. It's like you want people to be able to be villains. You want to be people to be able to be saviors and, you know, all that sort of stuff too. And I'm learning as I go. The development cycle for Four Souls was like a couple months. Most of it was done during the Kickstarter. It was just like, all right, let's play it again. But let's this time put this rule in place and we'll see how this plays out. So it was less prototyping back and forth with a programmer and seeing one little thing change and then testing it by yourself, and more watching people experience something with a slightly different rule set that you can completely change as much as you want every game and see what works. It was very free and really cool experience.
I think that's fantastic. You know, like I think that it also probably speaks a lot to kind of the isolation of self-development.
Yeah.
You know, you're writing, you're drawing, you're focused, you're by yourself. Of course, you know, you talk with other people, you interact with other people, but it's not the
same.
Says
you. I talk to no one.
Oh, okay. Well, then, but you, like you said, with Four Souls, you had that group vibe. You had people to bounce off of, and I think that's usually like I know for me personally, that's where I thrive, is when I have someone to bounce off of and suck energy out of.
For sure. And I tried to like explain that as this is why Four Souls is fun, because there's a surprising amount of people out there who don't play board games, card games, or any social games in person with people. They just don't. Like, I don't, you know, I don't have friends. And you know, that's basically what they say, and that's the end of it. And there, so there's a lot of people who don't realize how unique the dynamics of a social game are. And I focused Four Souls on being a very social, you know, you could be a very diplomatic, you know, you got to play the room, and it changes. Not only is the game dynamic and randomly generated, but the people are as well. And the people that you play with, depending on who you play with, there's different play styles. I remember a developer came up to me and he was criticizing a design aspect of the game, which was a global design aspect of it. And he was like, why would anybody help anybody else? And this kind of shows the personality of the person. Like,
oh, okay.
It's like, okay. And he's like, well, in my experience in games like this, you just are out for yourself. Why would, what incentive do you have to help somebody else? It's like, well, I'm sure this game would play very differently in your home, as opposed to somebody else's. So there's just such a range of players, and there's players who just like to grief. They just like to cause chaos. Yeah. And you know, you learn those different player archetypes, and you make archetypes to play to those players. It's just fun. I highly recommend anybody who's interested into developing or designing anything, just grab a bunch of cards and try to make a card game. It's surprisingly fun. It's surprisingly easy. It's you'll learn a lot. I think I learned a lot. I don't know how much I can use it anytime soon in the projects I'm working on now, but I'd like to think eventually if I ever make like a multiplayer game, that there are things that I've learned from my experience with Four Souls that I can utilize and use in a multiplayer kind of social environment.
Absolutely. And so that will bring us, you know, to kind of the newest thing announced recently. You can pre-order it now on Steam, is kind of, you know, we can call it Isaac the Whole Shebang, is The Binding of Isaac Repentance, which is a collection of kind of all the DLCs that have been available, plus new DLCs. I guess, you know, my first question here, one, very excited, but I am an old school Isaac fanboy. Who are we selling this to? Are we trying to package this to old Isaac fans? Are you trying to reach out to new Isaac fans? A little bit of both? Who are we selling it to? Why make this? I mean, I'm excited, but why make it?
It's just...
if that's a question.
The only reason this is being made is this. A few years ago, a mod came out called Anti-Birth. Mm-hmm. And it was this free mod that was very impressive, to the point where I was like, I want to hire this guy. Like, ooh. I want to work with this guy on, because I was doing booster packs for the current DLC, which was Afterbirth Plus. And I wanted to work with somebody like this on this project. So I contacted him. His name's Vin. And I was so impressed, not by just the technical things and whatever else, but I was very impressed that the themes, the vision, like, it's so easy for somebody, this kind of goes back to the Edgelord stuff. It's so easy for somebody to come up to me and be like, hey, you're fucked up. Didn't you like that movie Irreversible? It's like, you don't know me. Like, okay, but that movie is good. It's a great movie, but I will never watch that movie again. No, I didn't enjoy that movie at all, but it was a good movie. Fucking horrible movie though. But that's the sort of thing, like, they miss the mark. And a lot of martyrs will do the same thing where they put in, you know, Isaac's fighting God now and Isaac has a gun and, you know, that sort of stuff too. And this whole mod through and through was like, felt like exactly what I would do. It was very strange. It was like, this person must have studied every game I've ever made. There's all these nods to like my own work. And like, yeah. It was just so impressive. And I was like, I want to work with this person. And Nicholas hired him on to help me finish the booster packs. And at some point in time, I'm like, can we just can't we just make this official? Like I could take this and I could weave it into the game. And this is how I do it. Like, this is how thematically I would do it. This is how I do it story-wise, you know? And it was just really cool right in the beginning to have somebody, you know, theoretically like, yeah, if we did this, how would we do it? And we'd kind of bounce ideas off each other. I never really worked before The End Is Nigh. I never worked with another designer.
Oh, okay.
You know, I was always this design Nazi who it's my world. Stay away, you know? And I think with age, I've come to realize that how important it is to get somebody to bounce the ideas off of. And this kind of, I feel like I've been able to see my work from a new perspective through the eyes of Vin. And it made me so excited to, with the idea of working on something like this again, it made me be like, whoa, like I'm back in. Like I was petering out at that point in time. Was that drop right around the last DLC. And I was he kind of pulled me back in and was like, well, kind of seeing the excitement of a new, fresh, young, non-jaded game designer. You know, I drank some of his blood and now I feel young again. And it made me feel like I want to do this again. And that's the whole reason. Like, it was just that. It was just like, wouldn't this be fun? Wouldn't this be fun? Wouldn't this, can I correct all the mistakes that I made with past DLCs? Can I fix these things? Can I, can I rework all this stuff? Like, and Vin and the team, you know, Nick and Sagittarius are all such diehards and have such cool ideas and unique takes on existing things that I did it because it was so, the idea was so cool. Like, that's it. You know, and it is, it's a bookend. It's like comes, you know, the first game came out 10 years ago and now we're getting like essentially an ultimate collection. And in this collection, I get to fix all of the little loose ends and I get to tune things up perfectly in a way, you know. I think people are going to shit when they realize what's in it. It's so, I'm so pleased. I'm very happy with it.
That's so good to hear. Where it's like, I know, like, a lot of times, you know, those of us who are fans of both video games and movies, we kind of talk about like the difference between them. And I think that truly one of the biggest difference is that collaborative environment. And, you know, on a movie, everyone is working with each other and they're bouncing off each other. You know, you have actors working with directors, working with writers, working with the lighting people. Yeah. And, you know, here, you know, you're just saying like you're understanding that collaboration here. In video games, oh yeah, you want to do this? Wait, whoa, maybe we could do this. And that's the kind of energy that I'm into.
Well, it's something that I kind of wished. I wish that you know, you learn as you go. And I'm glad that I was open enough as, you know, a designer to allow myself to not think that I know it all, you know. Or not so much. I know it all. I do know it all, but but it's not so much that I don't know it all. It's that I know all that I know is from this. This is all I have. I see no other perspective, and that is a hard and profound realization that I will carry forward. And doing so now, like working with Tyler, I a little bit of the design, I shared some level design, which was hard for me with The End Is Nigh, with Tyler, and it worked really well. And I like that. And with Mugenics, I'm working with Tyler again, and there's a lot of riffing and it's so cool. And it's a lot less lonely too. I don't know why I was so anal about complete and utter control of everything. You know, I think that honestly, if I'm being honest, I think the thing that made me pull back a little bit was the fact that I have two children and a wife and I don't have all the time. I can't kill myself just working constantly like I used to. I can't take the whole workload and I need help. And in working with other people, especially with Four Souls and stuff too, you get to work with other creatives and allowing their input to bleed in was something that when I was younger, I used to think would taint my work.
Sure.
And now I feel like, I mean, I'm still a control freak. Don't get me wrong, but But I feel like I allowing these things to flow in and out definitely makes for a better final product. That said, I don't think I would ever put it through. It's one of those environments where, you know, maybe you got, it's me. I don't know how it works. I think in writer's room, it's probably a lot of people, but for me creatively, having one other person that I can bounce off of at maximum two input wise, anything after that, I think it's hard to, establish, it's hard for somebody not to want to put their foot down on an idea. And then, you know, you get the kind of a conflict situation. But again, I'm learning as I go. I don't know.
I think that's pretty standard. Like, you know, whenever you like see a writer's room, it's like all the writers, but like whenever like there's a, like an actual writing happening, I think the rule of thumb is three, maybe like three. Hell, if you're talking four, no, yeah. Just go into pairs of two, like two, three, maybe if you're good with each other.
It makes sense. I mean, that's one of the reasons why, when I see like indies going large company and stuff like that, not people ask me, will I ever do that? And my answer is always no, because number one, it's because the idea of me being responsible financially for a large group of people seems like, oh, I would never sleep. Like it would be so, so awful. It's already hard enough for me now working with like one other person and feeling like, am I wasting this person's years? You know, is this on my stupid ideas of poop and whatever else?
That Catholic guilt never leaves you.
I guess absolutely. Not. I guess not.
Absolutely.
But in situations where I've had larger groups of people, it tends to get dicey. And there tends to be more conflict than necessary, I think, especially with creative control.
No, I think that's a really optimistic point that I'd like to end on, just because we're getting close to an hour here. And I don't want to take up too much of your time, which is like that realization of like, it's okay to ask for help. It's okay to collaborate with other people. And more importantly, it's okay to do what you enjoy and trust your own instincts.
For sure. I think it's important. I think it's important to trust your gut with a lot of stuff. Unless you're a big dummy, don't do it. You gotta be realistic. If you're if your life is fucked up, okay, and you can't keep your shit together, you're not the person to trust and listen to. just saying. Just
look around.
And that goes for other people too. If somebody else is like in control of this and you see that like they're living in squalor and you know they're high 24/7 or drunk 24/7. Maybe don't take life advice. Just saying, it's probably not going to go well. And that goes for you too. You got to be realistic with yourself and know yourself enough to be like, wait, am I an idiot? What is this, a bad investment here? Should I not be spending my, people come up to me and they say, hey, I saw any given movie, quit my fucking job. I have no health insurance anymore. I have a wife and kid. It's like, what? What?
Why did you do that?
What are you doing? There's other ways to go about this. Please don't put this on me. Take care of yourself.
By the way, thanks for taking my optimism and just shitting all over it, Edmund. I really appreciate that. This interview went downhill.
They know. They know who they are. They know. They know deep down.
They do. Well, thank you so much for joining me once again. I've been Jack Packard, a semi-professional video game enjoyer here for The Escapist. Edmund, how can people follow you, find you, not your address, please, but just your social security number?
You can follow me on Twitter. That's the only place that I'm available. Sometimes I will take a sanity break and I will go away. That's expected. I will go crazy. I will lose my mind. You won't know it, but I will be totally insane offline. And when I'm not responding to your messages, it's because of that. It's because I need to take a break. But that's the only place that's basically, yeah. I mean, everything's connected through there. Just Edmund McMillen, I think my Twitter name is. I don't know if it's Edmund M or Edmund McMillen. I don't really know.
@Edmund McMillen. That's it.
Edmund McMillen. That's my full name. Look me up on Twitter. I'm there.
You're great. You're great at self-promotion.
Subscribe, follow, like.
Give a heart. Give a heart, maybe. Can you do that on Twitter?
Complain. Troll me. I'm here. I'll respond. I will take the bait. I still take the bait.
We gotta teach you.
I get mad. I get so mad.
Bye-bye.
Bye.